want to really get under my collar and make me angry? You want to really see Patricia Dixon get angry? Is you mess with my military. Now, I don't know whether you've heard about it or not, but in the news, they're talking about this lieutenant colonel that have been he has been relieved of his command simply because he sounded the alarm of the dangers of this Marxism and critical race theory ideology that has crept into our military and that's causing division among our ranks. Now, I was wondering when somebody in the military was going to stand up to this foolishness. Because, you know, all the organizations and the institutions within the United States of America, out of all of them, the military has been the one that has kept this focus, okay, kept the focus on the mission, which is defending this country, protecting this country. The military was the only institution that had not gotten involved with politics. You know, I know the generals up high, it's all political for them to even get their positions. A lot of that has to do with politics, but they kept it up there. They never let it come down to the ranks and interfered with the mission, okay, the mission. But since Biden's been in office, and they're using January 6th as a reason to just unload all of this stuff they've been wanting to do for years onto our military. Okay, so what they've done is they've called, they've had a shutdown, a down day for extremism. And they're using January 6th as a reason to talk about extremism amongst the ranks. And listen, I spent 21 years in the military, Army and Air Force. And if you want to talk about diversity and inclusion, then you're talking about the military. The military is the most diverse institution in the United States of America. Now, you can go back and talk about the past, because that's what race baiters like to do. I remember when one time we used to be segregated. Okay, it's a whole lot of stuff used to be. But that's no longer the case. If you want to talk about diversity and inclusion, then the military is the place you should be. Because let me tell you something. I grew up in a small town in Tennessee. And the only people that I ever encountered were white and black. I had a lot of white friends and black friends. But I'm saying those are the only people I had ever seen. I had never seen a Hispanic. I had never seen an Asian. None of that until I joined the military. And my very first week at my permanent duty station in the Army, a Puerto Rican guy in the mess hall, that's what we used to call the dining facility. We used to call it the mess hall, asked me out on a date. And I'm telling you, I was just shocked. I couldn't believe it that he was asking me out. Now, I didn't know he was a Puerto Rican. He was a Puerto Rican. I didn't know it because he had really light skin. I thought he was a white guy. And I turned him down 5 days straight. He came up to me every day in the mess hall asking me out. Finally, I said yes. I said, but it'll have to be in the daytime. So that Saturday, we went out. We went on a date, basically. And he asked me, he says, why were you acting like you didn't want to go out with me or that you were shocked that I was asking you out? And I just told him, I said, well, where I'm from, you know, blacks and whites, this was back in 1988, 89, in my little town, black and white people were not dating then. And he got so angry with me, he said, though I dare you call me white, I'm not white. And I said, what do you mean you're not white? He says, I'm Puerto Rican. Well, I didn't know the difference. I'd never seen a Hispanic. My first roommates in the military, you know who they put me in the room with? This is what they do in the barracks, in the military. You want to talk about diversity and inclusion. Because they want, see, we have to be a cohesive unit because we have a mission. We have to fight. We can't fight each other. We have to fight the enemy. So the first thing they do is they throw you in with all races. My first roommates in the military was a white, a Hispanic, and me. They had three of us in the room together. Everything is together. There was no division. And if you fought with anybody, regardless of whatever their race was, especially females or male, and you know, if you're a male and you fought somebody, they put that person in and make you roommates with them. Same thing with female. If you couldn't get along with one of your fellow troops and there was a fight, oh, that became your roommate because we had to get along. There was no fighting to the point where we were divided. you know, it wasn't no fight because of racism. When people fought, they were fighting over stupid stuff, but it wasn't because I'm black and you white. None of that stuff was allowed. So for them to claim that the military is full of extremism and white supremacy, that's a lie, people. That's a lie. And it made me angry when I was hearing about it. And then this general, I mean, not general, he's a lieutenant colonel, stood up. And I was saying, because I kept saying, is anybody going to stand up to this? So, of course, he speaks out about the dangers. Because, see, if you divide the ranks, we cannot win any wars. It's a threat to our national defense. Okay? The enemy can come in. You know what they say, divided we fall. United we stand, divided we fall. That's the truth. If you get the ranks, you get all the troops fighting, saying you are white supremacist and you think you're better than me and you this and that and all of that, what happens? And you got a lot of young troops coming in. They're already getting it from the school systems, the foolishness. But when you get in the military, they straighten out everything you've learned. I don't care what it is. All that's out the door when you join the military. There's no individualism in the military. Everything is, we as a unit. So they are relieved, and they have relieved this lieutenant colonel for speaking out. He wrote a book about it, and his book is shooting up on the bestsellers list. You know why? Americans are fed up with this. American citizens are fed up. This is all, see, when we hear this, and I'm guilty of it myself, you think, when you hear all this foolishness on the news and the liberal media, you think everybody, it's a whole lot of people for this stuff. Because that's how they make it sound. But it's really just a minority group of people that's pushing all of this foolishness. The critical race theory. You know what the critical race theory teaches? First of all, America was founded in 1619 when the slaves got here. First of all, they don't even know how the slaves even got here. See, I'm a historian. I call myself a historian because I study history. So I just gave myself that title. But they want you to say that America was founded as soon as the slaves got here. They want to make slavery the main thing of America, the most important thing. These are stupid people. They're highly intelligent, but they're still stupid because they find a way to use all these big words and all these theories they create to try to make you forget about real history. Okay, America wasn't even a country then in 1619. But they want you to forget about 1776 when the country was really founded, when we fought and got our independence from Great Britain. They don't want you to talk about that. So they're wanting to teach it to kids, basically young people coming into the military, young people in the university. They want to teach it in the school system that this is a racist country. They want to forget all about all the things we've done to overcome all the mistakes we've made. Yeah, we made mistakes. We had slavery. We had segregation. We had Jim Crow. We had this. We had that. But you tell me, race baiters, anybody listening to this video, just name one of the things that we did that was wrong in this country that we haven't fixed. You can't go by your own individual experiences. I'm talking about as a nation. All the things that they claim is wrong with America, we fixed. Why do you want to live in the past? Why? Because, see, America's doing too good. There's not enough race baiting going on. There's not enough racist crimes going on because most of the time when there's some kind of racist crime, they say a hate crime, it comes out to be a hoax, and the person that reported it is the person that did it. That's how far America has grown from all of this. So we don't have so they have to make up stuff. Okay, they said the greatest threat to America right now, to this nation, is white supremacists. Where are all these white supremacists? Who are they? And these are people at the top in the FBI and the Department of Defense pushing this lie on Americans that the greatest threat to this country right now, they say in 2021, is a white supremacist. Now, I've never met a white supremacist in my whole life. I guess to them, though, white supremacist is anybody that's white. That's how it comes down to, because I have never met anybody. Because those kind of people are proud. Those white supremacists and all that, they'll tell you they won. So when people tell me, I've met a lot of them. I had people tell me on Facebook, I've met a lot of them. I said, did they self-identify as a white supremacist, or are you just calling them one? Of course, I don't get an answer because, you know why I don't get an answer? Because they have said it. Nobody has met a white supremacist. I doubt it. Not too many people can say they've actually met a white supremacist. Because like I say, they are proud to be what they are. And they'll tell you they are one. You just can't call every white person you see a white supremacist. Okay? So I am tired of this. I'm tired of it. Now, this is what upsets me the most about all this race baiting that they're pushing out to America, especially American blacks. They make it seem like that white people, period, white people are going home every night, sitting around their table, talking about black people. That's why they act like that we are all on their mind, how to hold down black people. Don't you know that white people, Hispanic people, Asian people all have the same issues they have to deal with in life? When they get home at night, they're not sitting around discussing black people. They're trying to figure out how they're going to get the money to pay for Susie's braces. Okay? Little Johnny needs some new shoes. They lose their jobs just like black people. They lose their jobs. Their homes get repossessed. They were affected by the pandemic. All the issues and problems that everybody has, they have them. So they don't have time. You think they're going home after, if they do have a job, if they haven't lost it, they're sitting around the table with their spouses and saying, how can we hold down black people? You think that's what they're talking about? We're not on their mind. Seems like that the white people are on the black race baiter's mind. But the white people are not thinking about black people. They're trying to live their lives. They're trying to figure out how they're going to pay their bills, how they're going to put the kids in college, how they're going to pay the rent. The same issues that everybody else has, white people have them. And it has nothing to do with black people. So I am tired of them always saying that white people are doing this and white people are doing that. Or white supremacists are the biggest threat to this nation. Come on, you probably can't find five white supremacists. You can find. But they're the biggest threat to terrorism, domestic terrorists, the white supremacists. The biggest threat. Not all of these Muslims. None of them. Those extreme Muslims that wants to destroy this country. They're not the threat. No. Some skinhead somewhere living on a ranch way away nobody ever even sees is a threat. So I'm just glad that this general, I keep calling him a general. He should be a general. I get this lieutenant colonel spoke up. And he said, and he was on Sean Hannity. He said everything, he put all those disclaimers out in front. Because, you know, when you're in the military, I'm not representing the military. Everything I say, I'm not. He said he went through public affairs office. He said he put it in the prefaces, his books, all of that. This has nothing to do with, these are not the views of the military. He said that. So, if that's the case, why are they keep saying this? Why did they throw him out? You know why? Because he put the truth out. That's why. He put the truth out because, see, when they want to claim he's being partisan, because, you know, no partisan politics are involved or allowed in the military. But that's exactly what they were doing. Don't you know that's partisan? They're calling it extremism in the military and extremism amongst our ranks and trying to teach critical race theory. That is partisan politics that's coming directly from the left. That's liberalism. But they won't call it that because that guy, that lieutenant colonel said that. He said they call it other names to try to slip it in. But he's right. So the only people that should be relieved of duty are the ones pushing it, not the one that's sounding the alarm. Because he said that this division is a threat to our national defense, and that man is telling the truth. Have a blessed day.